At this point, good afternoon. On behalf of the American Action Forum and the Manhattan Institute for Policy Research, I'd like to thank everyone who's taking time out of their busy schedules to come and hear our discussion today. If politics is the art of the possible when it comes to healthcare reform, we are thinking thoughts that we thought were impossible just a few weeks ago. I think the discussion today will focus on what we've learned over the last 6 years. Are we going to have, continue to have a very partisan disagreement over national healthcare structures and national approaches to healthcare reform? Or is there room for state experiments and for us to continue to learn from the laboratories of experiments that different states have pursued, that there is not going to be a perhaps one-size-fits-all solution to all of our healthcare challenges, but that we can continue to learn from different state experiments, different provider experiments, different employer experiments that can help us deliver healthcare more effectively and less expensively than we've done before. So to kick off our discussion today, I'd just like to call up former Congressional Budget Office Director, Dr. Douglas Holtz-Eakin.
Thank you, Paul. Is this on? Victory? Little red light is on. Is it working? Sort of. Okay. I'll yell at you. Now it's on. So we're delighted to have the chance to have this discussion about the future of healthcare and with the Manhattan Institute. And I am delighted to have two distinguished panelists to give us the roadmap for the future. Seated to my left, Congresswoman Allyson Schwartz, who began her career as a health services executive, served in the greatest state legislature in the United States, the Pennsylvania House. And then represented Pennsylvania and the Philadelphia area, wrong side of the state, sorry, from 2005 to 2015. She is currently the president and CEO of Better Medicare, and we're delighted to have her today. Seated to my right, Senator Tom Coburn, a family physician by training, served in both the House and the Senate, in the Senate from 2005 to 2015, and has the added allure of being a serious budget hawk and one of my heroes, and delighted to have him here today. Wanted to talk about the landscape for the future of healthcare, and this is a really important time to do that. Everyone is hearing the discussions about repealing and replacing the Affordable Care Act. That in and of itself raises lots of important questions of both process and substance, where the goals, where we're trying to go with federal health policy. But implicitly, it also raises the questions of what do you want Medicaid to look like, because it's a very important piece of the Affordable Care Act, and what do you think is the future of Medicare itself, because it was also woven into the architecture of the Affordable Care Act. So the repeal and replace movement definitely raises all three. It also comes just on the heels of having the most recent national health expenditure data released, where we saw, once again, return to what seems like the old days, where healthcare spending grew at 5.9%. National health expenditure per person exceeded about GDP per capita growth by 2.1 percentage points. The notion of excess cost growth seems to have resurfaced. And we're once again in a moment where we're faced with issues of coverage, issues of cost and spending, and the real question being, what should the federal government do? So I'm delighted to have our guests here to have this discussion. And I thought just begin by giving each about 3, 4, or 5 minutes to frame what they think are the most important issues, and we'll go from there. Allyson.
Oh, senators first, but okay. Political aside, lead elected office in a Senator, I'm happy to kick this off, and Deb and I have worked together on a number of issues, conversations, particularly about the SGR and what we should do about that and how we would replace it, not just get rid of it. So thank you for the good conversations we had, and you encouraged me what I was doing as a member of that of the House. And we certainly overlapped those 10 years, and I certainly answer in a sense. So, Senator, good to be with you. Just a couple of comments I'll make as we get into this discussion. And the idea of talking about the landscape of healthcare and healthcare policy, right now is a rather big topic. Obviously, a great deal of conversation. Healthcare is top of mind in, for the president-elect and for the Congress, the congressional leadership, particularly around repeal the Affordable Care Act. And I'm pleased with the initial comments that Doug made, which is the conversation about the Affordable Care Act, so talked about, importantly so, what does it mean for everybody under 65? Less about what it, the impact that it has, because there are numerous provisions there for Medicare. And so I won't speak to that specifically, and I'll talk more to the other issues. I'm happy to speak to it, certainly to Medicaid as well. But there are parts of the ACA that have a real impact and have on Medicare and Medicare Advantage, the one that I've been for up to now, and we are in a very different place in a way just 8 years later in terms of the growth of Medicare Advantage, the intentional growth of service delivery reforms and innovation, and really moving to improve the care that's provided to everyone under Medicare, to seniors, but also those with disabilities, and to do so by changing the delivery system to really be reoriented, one, in terms of the risk, to use a capitated system and incentivize both the plans and the beneficiaries to participate in a very different style of healthcare delivery, particularly the one that focus on early intervention, identification of chronic illnesses, attention to those with multiple chronic conditions, and to do all that you can to provide the very best and appropriate care in the least, in the most cost-effective way. So care in the home, involvement of practitioners and teams and recognition of again, early intervention, and reaching out to patients rather than waiting until they come to your door really sick at the ER, and really working in a very different way. So one of the things about Medicare Advantage, it has grown, obviously, 65% in the last 8 years or so. We're now at a third of Medicare is Medicare Advantage. Significant. That's almost sort of an interesting program over there. It's a part of Medicare. That's the way beneficiaries see it. And it is moving, I believe, really the dime, both the dollars and the delivery of care for 18.5 million beneficiaries. I will say it's not all done, so we have to be complete. In fact, in many ways, some of these reforms are very much just hitting their stride. And the ability to change the healthcare delivery system in America is not easy, and it's not done quickly. But it is happening, it needs to happen to more value-based paying arrangements for providers, and it's making a difference in terms of outcomes, reducing avoidable hospitalizations, lowering and disease progression, slowing down disease progression, and improving care, particularly for the millions of seniors who have multiple chronic conditions, they're very high risk, high cost. And we have to be very careful as we move forward to repeal the ACA, that we hang on to those incentives, the quality incentives, that we enable those kind of conditions, and then we enable this public-private partnership to do what it does so well, which is to have appropriate government oversight, accountability for quality, pushing things in the right direction, but then letting the private sector really test out different models and let it work in different ways in different parts of the country. And that's what it's doing. So it's pretty exciting. I'll just end by saying it's having an impact for service as well. Not a small thing to mention, but there is a real effort to say, let's take what is working in Medicare Advantage and apply some of those to improve contain costs and improving outcomes in Medicare itself. And that's what we want to talk more about. And I will say that in the list of great growth in costs, Medicare was in a pretty good place at 1.7% growth in cost. That's pretty amazing. And one final comment is that we should keep in mind that when we're talking about cost and growth, that the number of people becoming 65 is going to have a huge impact on what we do. So improving per capita and driving costs in the right way, improving care, there's no question that we're almost going to double the number of seniors in the next 10 years. And that's going to be a huge impact on Medicare and actually on healthcare in this country.
Great. Well, everybody realizes that we're at an inflection point right now in terms of what's going to happen in healthcare. And I think there ought to be some parameters that Congress uses as they approach whatever they decide to do. And I think the first is don't lose the art of medicine. And that's actually happening today. The art of medicine is 60% of medicine. It's not the physical basis of medicine. It's not diagnostics. It's actually listening to patients and spending time with patients. The second thing that I think is important is how do we incentivize productivity gains with the quality gains that we want to achieve? And if you look back since 1998, there's been no significant productivity gains in healthcare. And yet, the dollars that we spend on healthcare have ballooned massively. And the example I use is go to a hospital parking lot at 2 o'clock in the morning and look at the employee parking lot. It's 80% empty. And then go to it, look at it at noon. It's 100% full. So there's a problem. If we're caring for people in the ER and we're caring for all the patients in the hospital and the things that we aren't doing is radiology, we're still doing lab and we're not doing surgeries, why are we consuming that much in terms of overhead in our hospitals? And that's just one portion of where the fat is. So I think as the Congress looks at this inflection point to change healthcare, they got to look at outcomes and how do we do that. They got to look at the incentives to improve access. A third point I'd make is Medicaid, if you're going for providers, they can get healthcare no matter what you're doing. And what we've seen is even though we've expanded Medicaid, we haven't seen a proportionate increase in good outcomes, even though access has increased. So I think looking at what we want for the country and how do we incentivize that rather than mandate it, how do we create the characteristics that are necessary to get great diagnostics at affordable prices with minimal waste and good outcomes, I think ought to be the goal. And it's not a matter of whether you repeal and replace. It doesn't have anything to do with any of that. It has to do with real people's lives. How do you give them affordable care? And how do they participate with it with incentives themselves as well as incentives inside the healthcare system? So I look forward to seeing what Congress does with that and how they do it.
A loving good luck from Mr. So
I want to hear your thoughts on delivery system reform.
I mean, there are a lot of critiques of the ACA which say what was light on was genuinely getting the productivity gains, bending the cost curve. If you could pick one, two, three things, what would you sort of encourage them to do to enhance productivity and improve the delivery system?
Well, I think I'd back up on regulations for healthcare. That's part of it. You know, the ACA mandated electronic health records, but didn't create a common language. So we've spent billions on computer systems that can't talk to each other. So I'd change that. I'd say here's the system everybody's going to use. That's one thing government can do. And you know, IBM actually offered their system to the federal government for free and was not even taken up on. I'd look at the ambulatory surgery center as a model for efficiency, because what we've seen is better outcomes there, lower costs, less complications. So, and I would put competition into the model. And if people say, well, you can't do that, yeah, you can. What I would do is let markets really work and let demand really work and give people the ability to utilize either tax credits, medical savings accounts, high-risk pools, all those things that are available to actually make good choices for themselves. And I'd incentivize prevention. But with that, you can't have an open pain system that no matter, overutilization is still a big problem in our country. And what we have to do is have some connection as we utilize healthcare. And what we do know in the past is the higher the copay, the less the utilization. That has positives, but that also has negatives. So go back to your original question. How do you incentivize? You let market forces incentivize. You actually put supply and demand in alignment and give people the tools. Transparency is the price. Right? How many of you know what things are going to cost before you buy them in healthcare? You don't. But the Amish know. They know every time because they ask. And they don't. They don't participate until they get an answer. So I think that we, if we would allow market forces to truly work, I'm not talking about taking away safety nets, but I'm talking about really letting market. That's one of the things that happens with Advantage, is there's a market force that people gravitate to towards Medicare Advantage because of the benefits, and they're looking at it and saying, I'd rather have that than Medicare.
We see Medicare Advantage as a part of Medicare, so so do beneficiaries, I have to say. And sometimes it's their language. So, well, we have Medicare, and they go, oh, I have Medicare Advantage, I love it. So, but I think some of the points are, well, essentially, ACA did a number of things that actually I think were not discussed as much when we were doing it, because there was obviously, oh, we didn't do enough of that bending cost curve. But let me just say, one, there are several things. One is, it certainly did incentivize primary care and prevention. It really did. And that's something we should protect going forward. But it said, okay, more residency slots for primary care. And it actually said it lifted the obstacle of a copay for screening and for primary care. Patient-centered medical homes, where you really have a team approach to primary care and really and incentivize corporate care coordination by so additional payment for primary care team coordinating care. Those are built into the ACA that are extremely important, and we're seeing the development of primary care groups across the country that are really doing different kinds of models all across the country, but embedded in those are some very important similarities. We're doing some work at BMA to articulate those. One we hear a good bit about is just that team approach and having a trusted, in addition to the physician, having a trusted person in that group we call and get in touch with, and reach out to you. Another is data sharing, which is extremely important, so you can identify and target high-risk patients who are well-known in the claims data, but not well known necessarily to the provider, and be able to say to the provider, this is the list of your patients who are in and out of hospital 3 to 4 times a year, do something about it, and they do, which is really quite extraordinary. The outreach that you're working with nurses, the home care is really extremely important. And working with those with community partners, who go into homes that are really be trusted and to identify problems. So hanging on to primary care incentives, Center's right, incentives I believe in also are extremely important. The second one is incentives for quality. Incentives for quality in Medicare Advantage, I think, are really quite an extraordinary lesson. We've seen a move from to 70% of beneficiaries in Medicare Advantage are in 4 to 5 star plans. It didn't just happen, they were financial incentives in this capitated system. It said if you meet these quality standards, we will give you a quality bonus. And they went for it. It's really extraordinary. And those extra dollars are used now. This is the way to hang on to those quality bonuses, but a third is the flexibility of our benefits. There's any extra dollar saved, half we put into helping beneficiaries. It can be reducing cost sharing, it can be enhancing benefits, it can be doing innovations like using telemedicine. So this is driving innovation that we well need to cost savings and do more than we are in Medicare. But using the private sector for that nimbleness that they can provide in offering benefits, testing them out, see what works, see where the advantages are, have been extremely important and a good lesson, I think, for us across the board. And I would also agree that the incentives around value over volume happens in the capitated system. It's one of the reasons we've seen the growth. And of course, involving the patient in all this. You can't do it without the patient being involved and engaged and trusting their provider and knowing what they have to do to improve their health and their health conditions. And I start to say that, again, the opportunity for competition and market forces has been beneficial in beneficiaries being able to make a choice. They stay in fee-for-service Medicare and make a choice for a capitated system. And not only that, they have a choice of plans within that. how much would they, what works for them? How much is their copay upfront? How much is a copay, you know, down to the deductible a year? Of course, with Medicare Advantage online fee for service, there's an annual limit on what they have to pay so that you know what you're getting into. And that's really very, very helpful. So they've made those choices, and most people have, they have 19 plans they can choose from. Not everywhere. It works a little tougher in rural areas, and we work to do there. But those are enormous incentives that exist in the Affordable Care Act that, when repeal happens, I think it will happen, that we understand the hell of the title was to keep the good stuff. I actually think it's a lot of good stuff. I mean, I have to just be careful going forward that we don't, because of political rhetoric, you know, sort of put out, dismantle systems that are working.
So the short version, what's your vision for where Medicare ends up? What would you like to see Medicare evolve to over the long term?
Well, I think it looks to see Medicare Advantage continue to be incentivized and grow. I think that's good. It's about 30% now. Let it grow as big as the market allows and the system quality provides. So we want to make sure that it's strong and that uncertainty, this is really my biggest point. I'm going into this, understand Medicare Advantage and some of those incentives. And some of this is true in fee-for-service as well, but more strongly in Medicare Advantage, is that right now we are asking healthcare providers and the system to change, to do more outpatient and think about less in the hospital. We're seeing that emerge, but uncertainty is not great for investments and investors. They think they're not sure this is going to stick around, they're not sure what the changes might be, if it can take months or years to get there. That I worry about what that does to investors' confidence, to plans making financial investments, to beneficiaries trusting that system, and to providers making the kinds of really strong and in some cases dramatic changes. So while the cost for these changes happening, I don't want to see those slowed down or undermined by either cuts or uncertainty.
Two-part question. One, in light of these concerns on uncertainty, what would be your advice about the process for repeal, replace? How should they handle that? And two, where do you think Medicare should go?
Well, my free market tendencies, but I'll answer the second part first, is you ought to create a way for people to advantage themselves in Medicare and get good health care. And that's one of the things that the Medicare Part C does, okay? And it wasn't long ago where they were trying to kill it because they didn't think it was effective, but it is highly effective. It does give people freedom. So, but I would say, here's what our average expenditure is per year on senior. Let's give them that and a tax credit and let them go out in the market. They can have traditional Medicare, or they can take the same amount of money and go buy something in the market. That creates pressure for Medicare to get better. And it creates incentives and competition for more efficient delivery of health care. And I forgot the first part of your question.
I'll first again, how do you live with that, and then I'll ask the question again.
Well, you know, that's where the devil is in the details, you know? I mean, that is set that way. Okay, let's have a conversation about what does that really mean, you know, in some of the details. I'm someone who does believe that the private sector can do great good, and really most of what we do in government, we actually turn over to the private sector at some point and they do it. But I do also think that adequate payment matters. So what that looks like in the future, that matters. How you determine what that average payment is, it's different in different parts of the country. Is that, you said, is it one cost everywhere, or is it cost per?
Well, yeah, we already that differential is already cooked in into the reimbursement rates. That's already cooked into all the reimbursement rates.
The question is what's cooked into it, what goes into it, and how is that set? What is the benchmark? You know, could we have some conversations? I agree that we need to keep moving the system to evolve to provide the best care and most cost-efficient way. I do. So how we get there, I just worry that some of those accountability for what the private sector does, the goals that we have for in terms of quality, then it doesn't get watered down to a place where it's not enough for either the plans or for traditional Medicare to be successful. And we have to be always conscious of that.
Well,
Well, your embracement of Medicare Advantage proves my point, is when people are given better choice and more freedom, they'll go to the one that gives them the best deal. And that's what Medicare Advantage is.
And so
the fact is with Medicare, there's been no productivity improvements in healthcare. So how can we say that we want to continue to accept a system that keeps wasting money, but plus it still has $100 billion a year of fraud, all right? $100 billion a year. I guarantee you Blue Cross Blue Shield of Oklahoma knows whether I'm a good physician or not. They compare me on every diagnostic code to every other physician that they pay out on. They know where the good doctors are. They know where the bad doctors are. They want to push people to the good doctors that are not only efficient in diagnosing, but efficient in terms of spending, not wasting money on diagnostic tests. So the point is everything else in our economy, we trust market forces to work on. And our assumption is either we're not smart enough, I'm talking to citizens outside of Washington, to make good choices for ourselves, even though we make good choices in most every other area of the economy, or that the elitism in Washington has to tell us what to do. And I actually trust people to make good decisions for themselves. Will they all know? Do you still have to have a safety net? Yes. But can you get better health care? I'm going back to what I started. Can you get better outcomes with a lower price, with better long-term care, incentivizing prevention, if in fact you spin it out? Just one example, moving to Medicaid. I guarantee you, if you truly block granted Medicaid out, the innovations in healthcare in most of the states would give us better care for our Medicaid patients at a lower cost. Right now, most Medicaid patients get shuttled to the worst doctors, not the best. And anybody in the healthcare knows that. So why would we give them a system that puts them with the worst doctors, with the worst care, with the worst outcome? Are we really giving health care? No, but we're feeling good about it. We've expanded a system that has very poor outcomes compared to the rest of the health care system. So why wouldn't we use market forces and give the states the chance to experiment, to find out what works best in their state at the most efficient level with the best care and the best incentivization for prevention?
So Medicaid?
Sure. Right now, states have tremendous ability to do some of the things you're talking about. In the sense of Pennsylvania, everyone on Medicaid is in managed care. I think it's 75% of states have done managed care, are doing managed care. They haven't really taken that managed care to a real service delivery reform. They get, companies get paid in a set amount of capitated rate, but they haven't really driven that delivery system reform.
Well, they have in North Carolina.
Yeah,
they've really made great savings. But the fact is they got a waiver from HHS to do that.
I think broadening those waivers, being able to enable and maybe even incentivize again to make sure that Medicaid is providing those incentives for change in quality and incentivizing a managed care system that works for our poorest people in this country is extremely important. But certainly, right now Medicaid is a state and federal responsibility. States can do without the federal government. The issue about block granting again, it's the devil's in the details. Maybe they're going to do it differently this time, but when I was on this budget committee and we had meetings in the House, then the plan was to block grant Medicaid and cut it a third. So, and it just means states are smart and they can figure it out. Well, like the SDR. Doctors are smart, just cut them, they'll figure it out. They didn't.
Well, we didn't ever cut them. No, we never. Let me give you the points on SDR.
I thought about that.
SDR was set up. Had they actually carried out SDR, doctors would have responded. But they didn't. They heard the doctors, don't cut us. And so what happened is the Congress never cut them. So SDR didn't work if you don't carry it out.
Exactly. But let me just say, I think Medicaid, there's a lot that can be done in Medicaid to make sure we're bringing higher quality. And again, the payments have to be accurate. Most of the doctors, and most of the who say this, they don't take Medicaid because it pays something. At least in Pennsylvania, I know the country tends to pay about 50% of statewide average in Pennsylvania, which means if you're a doctor in southeastern Pennsylvania or Pittsburgh, you're getting paid maybe 20%. Maybe 20%. Tell me doctors, you know, are taking it. If not, that's why so many poor people in Medicaid end up in hospital ERs. And the hospital, they give us community health centers. And, those are, that there's no options. There's no real options. So really making sure that our state is safe, very seriously. How can you create real options with decent payment for physicians and more broadly health practices to take care of poor people the right way? Look, understanding the old social worker made that social determinants of health also make a difference. And this isn't being a softy here. You find out from almost anyone who's serious about improving care for people with multiple challenges, particularly poverty, then being able to have the resources to follow patient, follow instructions, and and do the things that are necessary to help them be healthy is not easy to do, and they need some support and help to do it.
We're going to get a
rebuttal. And that can reduce costs as well.
We're going to get a rebuttal, but I just want to warn the audience, we're going to turn it over to you for questions, yeah. So start thinking. So
the rebuttal is this, Allyson says, to make sure they give care the right way. Well, who knows what that is? Washington, I guarantee it doesn't. And who cares about people in their state more than the people in the state? So the whole assumption, the whole elitism of Washington knows best has given us a Medicaid system that gives us worse outcomes at a high cost with poor access to the best physicians, the best facilities, the best diagnosis. So who decides is the question. And what we just heard is Washington decides. And what I propose is that the states decide. With the same amount of money, I'm not talking about cutting money, I'm talking about let the states decide. The assumption is that Washington knows better than what the governor and the head of HHS in the individual states knows. I don't think that's true. And we do see a differential in costs. You know, it's a whole lot cheaper to get sick in Oklahoma than it is back here. And there's a lot of reasons for that. But again, the point being, who decides?
So we are going to open it to questions. If you have a question, please go to that microphone there in the aisle, state your name and your affiliation, ask your question in the form of a question with a question mark at the end, and direct it to someone on the panel. And while that process is getting queued up, I would be remiss if I didn't get you on record on the question of the hour. Should we repeal and replace, repeal and delay, not repeal? What do you advise?
Repeal a good portion, keep a good portion. You can replace it. You can repeal it all and replace it, put it right back so that there's no real change. But it's going to take time. You can't do this in a short period of time. What you want to do is make sure nobody gets harmed no matter what we do. You don't want to make the system worse. Mm-hmm. And so I think you can have a repeal and replace, and you can do that effectively, but you still got to think about what's the outcome for individuals as you do that.
Well, this will be a short answer. I would tell you repeal and don't replace it. I would have a clean understanding of what that replacement is without actually really creating a great disruption in healthcare in this country, and certainly in how people take care and coverage.
Hi, my name is Robert Book of HSI Network. You mentioned that the ACA has incentivized primary care. What evidence do we have that consumption of primary care has actually increased since January 1st, 2014?
Has it increased? I know in Medicare Advantage we do have some figures that show that there is increased use of primary care.
How much?
What's that number? I think it was 25% more prevention visits, wellness visits.
That's not the whole of primary care, right?
Well, it's in Medicare Advantage. I can show you the study, we can pass it along.
No, I mean, outside Medicare Advantage.
I think, that I'm going to have to check on more broadly in Medicare, but in fact, we have seen evidence, and I'm happy to share that with you. We've seen numbers, and I think, again, between 20 and 25% more people are taking advantage of a primary preventive visit and seeing the primary care.
So when you say preventive visit, does that mean there was this issue with colonoscopies where you get your preventive colonoscopy where they actually find the polyps then it's considered therapeutic and not preventive, and you have to pay for it. Are we correcting for, you know, that kind of prevention?
Well, I don't know the specifics about colonoscopies. That's one screening procedure that actually no one rushes to do, I have to say. So, using too much prevention, you know, I think that's one case where no one's going to overdo it. That's an argument I answer to your question that you're going to sometimes not find something. It was a screening procedure, and if it's covered, then you should be covered.
Let's have our sidebar and research exchange here. Go to the next one.
Hi, I'm Penny Starr with CNS News. Senator Coburn, you talked about letting the states do it. So does repealing and replacing Obamacare to you mean getting the federal government out of the business except for entitlement for health care, letting the states be in charge?
I actually it's philosophical. I represented 4 million people from Oklahoma. How many of them got to talk to me while I was a U.S. Senator for over 10 years? Not many. If I'm a representative in the state of Oklahoma, I may have 40,000 people. And they can actually have some impact on me. So the fact is, I'm for the freedom to bring it back for people. The people get to make the decisions, not the bureaucrats and the ups in Washington. And so what I would specifically do right now is I would put a waiver out for everybody that wanted a block grant and give them their money at the same incremental growth for a period of time and see how they do. And let's see what happens. You know, Rhode Island did a great job for a number of years because they had a waiver from the Bush administration. And their Medicaid costs, their outcomes improved, and their costs did not rise. So we already have some proof. So my philosophy is let the people that are closest to the people make the decisions on that. And the fact is there are some really small, I've been in 25 states in the last 2 years working on another project. I find that the people in the state houses actually care for the people a whole lot more than the people in Washington care for the people. So I would move that and let them make those decisions on what works best in their states. And I guarantee you we'll save money. The states will. And then let the states use it for prevention. Let them use it for tobacco cessation. Let them use it for whatever they want to use it, if in fact they're saving that money. But the key is how do you get better outcomes? You don't have to necessarily save money, but how do we get better outcomes for the money we're spending? Because that's the real problem. You know, whether there's multiple studies that say $600 to $800 billion a year is not spent, that's spent in healthcare isn't helping anybody. So there is room in this healthcare scenario to get better outcomes and actually cut costs and save people's lives. And so I believe the best way to do that is at the local state level, where you actually have some input. When something isn't working right, you can actually change it. And whereas up here, it's all you got.
In the moment, just reiterate that states now is where this could happen under the new administration to even allow those waivers for Medicaid and to be able to use incentives with certain waivers. The Medicaid is a state-run program.
Well, it essentially is not. It's mandated that you can't get a waiver unless the Department of Health and Human Services gives it to you.
They have a lot of power and a lot of authority to do much more than they're doing now. I encourage them to do to be able to provide more managed care, better care, demand more outcomes, have more accountability from the doctors and providers. But again, understand that I'll leave it there. But you can't then cut it dramatically to the states and say we want you to do a much, much better job until the beginning of an innovation. But there's more they can do within the dollars I have. So let's and really creating that disruption for the 8-10 million people who are on expansion of Medicaid is really something that will certainly create a lot of uncertainty for states.
So you're both experienced legislators and politicians, and so I guess I'd ask your question about the political dynamic of the moment, which is both of you that if you're going to repeal the older part, you're going to need time to replace. What advice would you give to Congress about that transition period and how the exchanges in Medicaid populations can be well served without putting Republicans in the position of being propping up Obamacare, which is a charge to come, and how do you sort of make sure you get the convergence to a good outcome in terms of the replace. That's a hard thing to do. Republicans have lots of ideas, but they've yet to see a single plan emerge. Any magic wisdom there?
Well, first of all, don't worry about what people are going to say. You know, care about people. But don't worry about what the politicians are going to say and what the political dynamic is. Do what's best for people. And you usually get a great political outcome. So that's the first thing. The second thing I'd say is go slow. You know, no matter what kind of mess I may think the Affordable Care Act is, some people are very satisfied with it. And so what you have to do is you have to move in a way that gives people ease and comfort that they're not going to lose what they now have and that they're going to have something equivalent or better in terms of outcomes and access, which they still don't have. For that. So my advice is go very carefully and create a plan, and you can do it in incremental stages. Like I said, the first thing I'd do is move Medicaid to a separate system, and I wouldn't touch Medicare right now at all. I'd allow as much Medicare Advantage as it wants to have. I'd allow that to roll as big as it can roll because it really does give people more choice, more option, more freedom. And then I would take the segments where we're spending money in the Affordable Care Act and create tax credits with it.
Yeah, I mean, certainly I like the notion very much of keeping what's not disrupting the changes that are made in Medicare and in the ACA, and again, maybe that's not what most people really heard anyway, and they want to say protect Medicare. And the president-elect just said he wants to protect Medicare. So first thing would be in the ACA is to protect the provisions within Medicare. That'd be great. We might even have a few suggestions about certainly, but okay, we're going to stay within that. Let's protect that. I mean, that is a very good place to go. I think you can protect the Medicaid expansion with some provisions for some additional waivers or authority of the states. If you want to do that, you can do that. And then I think it is going to be very difficult to not cause some disruption for all the people who got subsidies, the 10 million who have subsidies that are insured now, who weren't insured before. Something has to be done to provide some assurance to both the markets, because those exchanges are already having trouble, not to be able to say, here's the kind of direction we're moving in, or some content there will create increased a disruption in that marketplace, and the undermining of that marketplace, and really not make clear how those people who now get subsidies would be able to continue to get help. Change the wording of the tax credits. Right now they're tax credits. So they are already a tax credit. But I could do a different kind of tax credit. We don't know what that means. But you need to have create some kind of clarity about the direction that you're moving in. I think leaving it unstated for years is really going to be very, very difficult. Although I agree with you that you can't dismantle it in a short turnaround. So maybe there's a suggestion of an intent to repeal. I think the Congress is going to, and the President is going to want to go further than that. So I do have concerns about how you create the assurances that there will be a replacement that anywhere near addresses the issue of access and improvements in delivery of care that exists now.
If you look at what's going to happen in the insurance market, what just happened this November in terms of rates, and what's going to happen next year, you know we have to do something. The Affordable Care Act isn't going to have anybody participating in any of the exchanges if something doesn't happen. So how do you fix that? We have a mandate that you have to have insurance, otherwise you pay a tax, right? So why not eliminate a mandate, create an incentive? I mean, Americans work much better on incentives than they do mandates. And so create a mandate. You know, our problem with the Affordable Care Act is young people aren't signing up. Now, we don't have true indemnification spreading the risk because the young people are participating. They'd rather pay the tax, and the tax costs them a whole lot less than what it would cost for them to participate. So why don't we incentivize them to participate? And if they take the tax credit, they have to participate. And therefore, you don't have a mandate anymore, but you have a better mix on the insurance side of it, which spreads the risk, and you won't, you'll have people coming back into exchanges rather than leaving exchanges. So these are problems that are all fixable, but you know what we have to do is disconnect the emotion, go back to the beginning of what I said. There has to be improvement in efficiency in healthcare. There has to be outcome improvement. There has to be transparency in both the outcome and the price. And there has to be freedom associated with your healthcare. There's nothing more personal than your healthcare. And when you go to an exchange and you have to buy one of the plans, like my staff and I did the last 2 years we were in Congress, and you don't get the freedom to decide what you want, you don't get to go out into a marketplace, you get a choice of four plans, and that's it. And when there's no market, actual forces out there give you 20 different plans, and the assumption is you're not smart enough to figure out what you need. You know, we've done irreparable harm in terms of markets for healthcare, and we see that by the way the insurance companies are exiting the exchanges. So it's not there, and if you go look at their numbers, they're actually losing their shirt. So how do we change that? And we've got to have participation. So if you want to create participation, then either you got to put a penalty big enough to cover the cost, or you got to create an incentive that causes people to do what's in their own best interest.
I'm going to give Congresswoman Schwartz the final word.
Well, as much of what Senator just said, that I would agree with, some of those exchanges need some work. We know that. And you know, we need to make sure that it does work and there are options and choices. But that the exchanges would do exactly what you're talking about, just to give people a chance to make choices, to choose plans, to do it in a way that they can really compare, and to provide tax credits so that they would have the resources to do it. I mean, I love incentives. I think that kind of, that's the conversation. Actually, not under repeal of Obamacare to do that. You can do lots of tweaking to improve the exchange design. I think everyone will be open to that. So it's, you know, I guess I would just say, neither of us are in elected office anymore. I spent hours and hours working on the Affordable Care Act and really trying to work out what would work and what wouldn't. And having never done this before in America, we had choices to make. Should there be improvements on that? Of course there should. You know, have we made changes in Medicare over the last 50 years? As there are innovations, are there changes? As we thought differently about approaches to health care? Of course there have been. So this is really, if this was a conversation about how do we just make sure that Americans have access to coverage and quality care at a rate they can afford and choices that they can make, I think we could get there. I hope the goals are actually that similar. If we were actually that, those are the goals, we share those goals. I think there's some underlying other issues here, and so I think that's going to make it much tougher to get this done in a way that, again, prevents disruption, uncertainty for both the payers and the providers and the beneficiaries. And my hope is that it doesn't do too much harm and that we can get to the right place. And all around, let's at least protect Medicare and the markets that exist and the protections that I think beneficiaries have had and have under the ACA, and that both, so I think I'll agree, we have to protect. Those with pre-existing conditions, those that can't afford it, those who are younger and older, and there's work to be done to get that done.
I'm going to ask our moderator, Alison Kodjak of NPR, and the second panel to come up. And while that's happening, please join me in thanking our panelists.
your drinks and additional snacks. I will start with introductions of our second panel. We have here three of the great thinkers in healthcare to answer your questions and mine. I'll start with Paul Mango. He's a senior partner at McKinsey. He advises health insurers and healthcare providers on how to deal with the Affordable Care Act and any number of other things. He's a graduate of West Point, and I'm told he was his wife and daughter, and a Harvard Business School. And when I looked him up, I found that he was a field artillery officer, which means he's good with cannons, rockets, and missiles, so watch out. Next, we have Kavita Patel, Dr. Kavita Patel. She is a primary care physician. Obviously, you can ask her the question that Congresswoman couldn't ask earlier. And she's also a non-resident fellow at the Brookings Institution. She was in the Obama administration at the White House during the creation of the Affordable Care Act and was central to sort of conceiving a lot of the ideas there. And while I had a little trouble finding an interesting factor about her when I did Google her, there was another Kavita Patel out there who is a love coach. Not sure if that runs in here. And last but not least, we have Paul Howard, who is the Director of Health Policy at the Manhattan Institute. He was an advisor to Governor Mitt Romney during his presidential campaign on healthcare policy. Paul is a black belt on something.
What? I can't tell.
You can't tell. That's and he, interestingly, has a PhD from Fordham in philosophy, and that will come into play very soon here. So, welcome all our panelists for a moment. Thank you. So I'm going to get into sort of the nuts and bolts of health policy in a moment, but first we're going to step back and meet some members in front of the American Action Forum. I'm going to ask sort of a big, broad question of our resident philosopher. And I think it's the underlying question that all this debate is around, which is, should healthcare be a public good? Should it be a shared responsibility? Or is it a product or a service that should be sold? And I leave that to Paul, because he's the big thinker on the crowd right now.
And my response to this?
Yes.
You know, I think, you know, I do get that question a lot. And I think that, you know, the question of whether or not, you know, if you begin from, is healthcare a universal right to which everyone has, you know, we have an obligation to supply that. I think that, you know, that kind of makes a moral sense to a lot of people. But that assumes that there is a quantity of healthcare that you could provide that would satisfy the need. And we have a technological frontier on innovation that is constantly evolving and changing, and new bundles and healthcare products and services are continually evolving, in some cases to meet needs we didn't know that we had. And the nature of health is changing in a lot of ways. I think we can be, you know, optimistic that you know, enormous healthcare improvements over the last century and certainly over the last half century were compressing disability in old age to a shorter and shorter period of time, to the point where my father-in-law has been retired for the last, you know, 10 or 15 years, because an awful lot of the time playing golf. He's in, you know, a lot of seniors are in good health, some of them are. But you know, we've made improvements to people's lives in their 40s and 50s, so that when they, you know, age into Medicare in their 60s and 70s, they're in better health than they were before. And our assumptions about you know, longevity and health and people's ability to continue to work are still set at where they were in 1965. And giving more market signals, I think this is one thing that I think there's probably a little bit more agreement on left and right about this. You know, increases the ability of us to put resources where they need to go and increase the productivity across the healthcare system. I think that's a big point of agreement. Is there's enormous, ridiculous amounts of variation in quality and pricing across the U.S. healthcare system that don't seem to have any relationship to each other. That is where you can say we can have a lot more opportunity to deliver healthcare efficiently, especially if we get better signals about prices and quality to providers so they can benchmark themselves, to employers so they can find better contracts and they engage more, and of course to individuals so they can seek out the places where they're going to get the best care for themselves and their families. But that's easier said than done, but I think that you know, is kind of a place where the rubber meets the road, the philosophical questions turn out to be not terribly helpful.
Well, I'm going to ask it anyway, Kavita. Just as a provider, in addition to a policymaker, where do you see the balance there? I mean, it seems like that's what we're struggling with.
So if you talk to most physicians, I think there's always this quintessential argument of whether healthcare is a basic human right, and you'll hear kind of back and forth, and I think that we have actually laws in place in TALA. Those of you familiar with the regulatory framework, we've made decisions way prior to the Affordable Care Act that state that if somebody presents themselves in chest pain or in any sort of traumatic situation, that we have an obligation to treat them. So I think that reflects what I would say is not necessarily a unanimous opinion, but we actually have that kind of broad, I think, consensus. And I agree with Paul that, you know, we have, we've layered onto this kind of philosophy, you know, regulatory structures that are incredibly complex, stark laws. I can go on and on about kind of the regulatory nature of medicine, and that includes malpractice and some of the things that I think people are hopeful that any future health policy could address. And then there's the emotional part of it that comes up, I think, quite a bit in the media around surprise bills and people who are desperately seeking health care and can't get access because the type of insurance that they have is not accepted by any providers, et cetera. I see it on the provider. The bulk of my time, by the way, is not, I used to work in these halls. My bulk of my time now is spent delivering patient care. And I see it all. I see everything from absolutely inappropriate utilization to what I would call under-treatment, which is, I think, something that efforts in the Affordable Care Act were trying to address. People who never went to the doctor because there was way too much sticker shock to pay out of pocket for very important services. And it's not just the preventive services, quite honestly, Allyson. The majority of what I see for people who are newly insured are incredibly complex chronic diseases or kind of the acute manifestations of very serious chronic diseases. So I'm not seeing a lot of like, just, oh, happy-go-lucky, let me do your physical and I don't find anything. So I think that there's that entire spectrum, and it drives, to be honest, it's driving up the cost of care because we don't really have, we talk about guardrails in policy, we don't really have guardrails in clinical care. We kind of still have a philosophy of do more, 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 and more. And I think that has to change.
A little bit on this issue, I got an email, as a journalist, I get a lot of emails from strangers today from somebody who is a medical thinker named Dr. James Orient, who argues very vociferously that we should get rid of insurance altogether, that it would create a whole different economic system for the healthcare industry. People just had to pay. That cost would go down. I'm wondering what you think of that. You deal with both providers and insurance companies. How much is padded up, and how much would people utilize less if they actually had to pay?
It's a great question. I'll just maybe talk about some consumer surveys we do, and we just did one a couple months ago. We do them every 3 months and try to get a sense for how consumers are thinking about things. And this one was between those who are insured and those who aren't insured, just to try to get a difference of opinion. And two things struck us as very interesting as it relates to your question. The first one was, what is the level of financial insecurity you feel? If you're uninsured versus if you have a ACA product. And interestingly, the folks who had the ACA product actually expressed higher levels of financial insecurity. So how can that possibly be? Well, because there has been some selection into the exchanges where those folks are actually sicker on average than those who have stayed out, yet they have these huge deductibles and they're paying a premium. So they feel actually net-net their financial exposure is greater because they feel there's actually a higher probability of a medical event that they're not going to be able to fund, whereas the uninsured folks don't feel like they have that same probability. But the second one was even more interesting, and that is we found out that those who were uninsured, 43% of them actually, and I think Dr. Coburn mentioned this as well, actually went in and tried to negotiate price and get a better deal. And what they told us was 3/4 of them actually got a better deal. Now, we did also some focus groups several years ago with uninsured, and, in our experience at McKinsey, we found them to be by far the most savvy healthcare consumers in the health economy. They knew what was an over-the-counter equivalent to prescription drug at one-third of the price. They knew what Medicare reimbursement prices were, and they started those negotiations with hospital CFOs. They basically knew a commercial laboratory diagnostic company does testing at one-fourth the price that a hospital outpatient does. Extremely savvy consumers of healthcare. So I'm not at all advocating and saying there shouldn't be any insurance. There should be insurance for insurable events. And I think the consumer can really exercise a lot of discipline into the market for non-insurable.
So given that, I mean, that seems to be sort of where this whole debate is coming down. And there has been all this talk about consumers having skin in the game, creating market forces. The ACA has, at its backbone, this idea of minimal benefits that need to be covered, the preventative care that is free to people when they go to the doctor. I'd like to hear both Paul Howard and Kavita talk about, you know, should we continue with the ACA being a little bit more of a nanny with the benefit, the minimal benefits and the free preventive care and requiring, or should we do that more skin in the game, high deductible health plan, save your own money for what you need on a regular basis?
I can go ahead and start. So the essential health benefits was modeled after, so just for like, because I think it's been enough years that people may or may not recall, what was put into place in kind of statute, the Affordable Care Act, actually kind of then was kind of delegated, if you will, to the Institute of Medicine, and then kind of through a process, came forward with these recommendations about what would be kind of adopted as, quote, essential health benefits. There have been a lot of criticisms of those actual benefits. I would argue that you need some, especially from an actuarial standpoint, you need some kind of basic, when we were talking about federally facilitated exchanges and plans that were going to go across all state lines, there was absolutely a need to have something that was very, like, you know, what would be kind of the minimum of what's required. And that included services like pediatric, kind of vision, dental. And of course, that is what's led, I think, to people criticizing the fact that if a 28-year-old male who has no dependents is trying to buy a plan, and there are all these requirements for services which that 28-year-old male will never access, is that really kind of appropriate insurance versus Allyson, what I think you're talking about, which might be either modifying those benefits or allowing for a high deductible plan. We looked back in the administration and in Congress, both parties, Democrats and Republicans, because another fact people forget is that we were really trying to achieve some bipartisan consensus on the bill. In the run-up to this, we looked at kind of having in place high deductible health plans, health savings accounts. All these permutations were discussed. And for a lot of different reasons, we landed where we did. Was that perfect? Clearly not. I don't think President Obama himself had said many times, this is not a perfect bill, this is not a perfect law, but it was a place to start. So I actually see, and I think Congresswoman Schwartz and Senator Coburn both were trying to express where there might be some bipartisan interest. I would hope that these are not mutually exclusive, that we could still have preventive benefits. I'll offer to you a successful model of prevention, the Medicare program. We can talk about colonoscopies offline if that gentleman is still interested, but I certainly see the value of having those preventive services given to seniors as part of an annual wellness visit. I deliver those cares. I actually do those visits. I did one yesterday, and it was incredibly valuable. So I think there are some basics to this notion of what's essential that should not necessarily come under kind of what a consumer might have out-of-pocket risk for. And I'll just leave it at that, but we can go back and forth as to whether even savvy consumers, and I have to tell you, Paul, I may just be the only doctor in the country who sees the unsavvy consumers, but I don't see a lot of savvy consumers in my practice, and I see Medicaid, Medicare, and a lot of commercial setting consumers. And I worry that we assume that, you know, the consumer has this information. Some of them may have it, but a lot of them don't. And I also say that prevention is a changing field. What we are doing in preventive care this year is not what I trained in medical school about 12 years ago. So I would say that there's a need for having that be part of what we offer to people without having all that responsibility be shouldered on patients themselves.
I think we're in, as I say, I think that, a lot of, you know, I think about, you know, I take this too, is that when I talk about consumerism, I think it off-puts a lot of people, maybe on the left and center, when you think about what is it we're really trying to achieve, and that is to give patients the information they need, and it may not be with skin in the game. If there's someone who, you know, for instance, needs to go in for a surgery, they're obviously going to blow through their $5,000 deductible pretty quickly. On the other hand, giving the most of five hospitals that are in-network that have different infection rates, different numbers of surgeries and other things, and saying, well, here's at the top of our list. Now, these are the five best hospitals. You should choose from one of them. We actually have information from that. Even administered pricing systems, like in the UK's national health systems, giving patients a choice of hospitals and informing them about those choices improves outcomes and drives competition. We've also got very interesting experiments going on with employers and systems like CalPERS, where they're saying, okay, here's what we'll pay for a knee or a hip transplant in the hospitals that are in network. There's 20 of them. Each one of them accepts a bundle. Essentially, this is a reverse deductible. And you can take that to any of these 20. You'll get high-quality service there. And there have been studies, I think, from James Robinson and his colleagues at UIC that have said prices have come down. Hospitals are competing there. So I think states actually, you know, we forget, states regulate an awful lot of healthcare delivery. I think that there's tremendous opportunity there for states to get involved and give patients the transparency and providers, again, the transparency tools they need to compete. I think you know, one thing that we've forgotten is we need an awful lot more competition in the healthcare system. And I think one of the advantages of driving some of this conversation back to the states is that states are finally going to have to look at their laws and say, could we have nurse practitioners doing more? Can we have better information through all payer claims databases and other tools that can help employers and others drive competition across the healthcare system? I think a lot of what we're arguing about, to Kavita's point, you know, it's the really complex patients, the really expensive patients that make the conversation difficult. And I think there's still a lot of room that we can drive there. Calling it consumerism may off-put people, but when you think of it in the sense of every patient needs to know where they can get high quality care, and every provider should be on the hook for and competing with other providers to deliver really high quality care. Instead, we tend to pay people to do certain things and pay more for certain, the exact same service in a different setting. And we can talk about why that is and academic medical centers and all that. I think there's actually an awful lot of room for states to drive a conversation there. And I'm just not sure that a medical home is appropriate for, say, every patient. I think that's what we're learning. There's not one, you know, size fits all that's going to work for every patient. I'd like to just see some, you know, more experiments, more data, more transparency that will drive some of the competition. I think that's the thing that we will not seem to the extent we need to today.
So now we're sort of face up to the potential of the repeal of the Affordable Care Act and the unknown of what's come after. I guess I want to first talk a little bit about the goal. It seemed that the original goal of the Affordable Care Act, at least the way it's described now, is to increase access, increase coverage to as many people as possible. When I hear Speaker Ryan talk about it, I don't hear those words as much as reining in costs. So I guess where should this is going to change? Where do you think the focus should be? Do we need to increase access to more people, or are people choosing not to have access if they don't want it, number one? And number two, how important is it to rein in costs overall in the healthcare system? Do you want to take that one or this?
Yeah, I'll start. I mean, I don't know whether it's going to be repealed or replaced or whatever, and I can't comment on it anyway, but I think there are a couple of first principles that we would like to see as part of whatever you know, whatever the solution is. And I would say there's three things that any type of evolution of reform would have to address. One is there's just a significant number of what we would call economic distortions in the healthcare system today. And what the exchanges tried to do was, because they thought that was the way we could expand coverage, was basically, in the truest sense of the word, socialize asymmetric medical risk. So put people into the same risk pool that had radically different risk profiles and hope that the cross-subsidy would somehow work out. And if you looked at it antiseptically, what they were hoping is the young would support the old, the healthy at any age would support the sick at any age, and that males would support females. That's just the way it works out actuarially. And what we find out in the exchanges is they're sicker, older, and more female than the background population eligible for the exchanges. So what does that tell us? Well, the consumer has gotten pretty smart in 3 years, and they have begun to optimize in a very, very interesting way. And if it continues, what we're going to see is a relatively high risk pool for relatively indigent folks who are getting big subsidies. And that's kind of what the facts would suggest where we are. So we have to eliminate those economic distortions, and that's one huge one. And my colleagues did an analysis of what percentage of the total healthcare dollars in the country are actually insured, and it was 30%. Well, we use insurance to pay for 60% of our health expenses. So we're 3,000 basis points overinsured and undersaved for our healthcare expenses, just from a pure economic perspective. So that's one. Two is, for whatever reason, beyond clinical innovation, business model innovation has evaded this sector to a large degree. You could say that's regulatory, you could say it's government imposition of certain rules and so forth, but at this stage, we need, you know, what I call, when I talked to a group this morning, frenetic innovation. I mean, at an unbelievable pace, if we're ever going to get out of this without rationing and without bankrupting country. So that would be the second thing. And then the third thing we would say is, if we don't get right to the root cause of what is 60 or 70% of our healthcare expenses, lifestyle-induced chronic disease, then we're never, you know, you can't go from, you know, 15% clinically obese to 35% in 30 years. We can't continue that trajectory. We can't, 95% of our diabetics are type 2 adult onset, right? We cannot ignore that and hope that we're ever going to have affordable care. So my hope is just wherever we wind up, we address economic distortions, we promote real innovation, you know, cut the providers loose to innovate. There's all types of wonderful technologies out there. And let's get right to those social determinants, and let's actually make people healthier rather than make them slightly less miserable in their suffering of disease. Let's actually make them healthier and prevent some of this from happening. So that's what I would say are three components of wherever we go, hopefully those are part of it.
Anybody else
want to
come?
Look, I really like that, because I agree with everything Paul said, just by virtue of the fact that, you know, why haven't providers done this before? Why haven't employers embraced this before? That why, you know, the system's design has not been an issue, because I think that, you know, in some sense, for a long time, we had the worst of both worlds. You know, we're just paying as we go, and everything that anyone orders gets paid for, and we don't have any pricing signals to the consumers or to the providers about, you know, what's high quality. We need to do a lot of that a lot faster, because a lot of our arguments over healthcare turn out to be incredibly bitter because they're so difficult when it comes to costs. And that there is, you know, even if you look within states, within cities, there are high quality providers who are providing care much more efficiently and effectively. But they're not rewarded the way they would be in a normal market. You don't have to tell Intel to make a better computer, or tell Apple to make a better operating system. They win in the market. And unless you have a system that provides those signals of quality and incentivizes people to seek them out, again, sometimes that's a pricing signal, sometimes it's a non-price signal. And I absolutely agree that, you know, especially for safety net programs, one of my colleagues who are tasked with that space, and we funneled, you know, a tremendous amount, I think 90% of increased safety net funding over the last 30 years through Medicaid. Well, the social determinants of health, things that are upstream from when we're providing care, maybe we ought to give that more opportunities for housing vouchers and increase earned income tax credit. We can have a really productive conversation across left and right and say, well, there are better ways to address the needs of the poor that can improve their lives and result in better health outcomes downstream. And so if we keep having arguments just about insurance, I think we're missing a lot of those bigger issues we've been trying to tackle.
Okay, so, but we're gonna have an argument about insurance, or at least a discussion.
So what would you keep in the Affordable Care Act, and what should it be fixed, and what should be thrown out?
I mean, I guess I'll go on record and say that I think we should keep the Affordable Care Act. I mean, in this entire room, who thinks we should keep the Affordable Care Act? 10 titles. This conversation about repeal and replace or repeal and delay is obviously it's an imperative that came from the election results. We would be having a very different conversation if the election went the other way, I can guarantee that much. So I'll state on record that when I worked in the Senate, how many times have we actually modified the original kind of Social Security Act and the establishment of Medicare? We do that all the time. So I don't think anybody thought that, you know, the 2010 version that Barack Obama signed would stay just as it was. So I am hopeful that all these conversations, whether they are a repeal, and by the way, the actual part of repeal, many people in this room know, but it's not all 10 titles. People are primarily talking about, through a budget reconciliation process, potentially to take away parts of titles 1 and 2 and maybe some tax provisions in 9. But I would like to see the current Affordable Care Act stay in place and find some consensus to actually take and make the measures for improvement to stabilize the individual exchange markets, to do some of the things that actually even the Democrats running up until the election were talking about doing. So I'll just go on record for saying that. And if we get to where it looks likely that there are parts of the Affordable Care Act that will be repealed, my biggest concern is that there is going to be such instability, and Paul probably knows this better than any of us, I don't see how I can talk to any carrier and give them any desire to hang around to see what they, quote, replace it with. I mean, if I'm a Blues plan, if I'm anybody, why would I stick around for that? So when I think about the deadlines for, I mean, insurers right now are not just thinking about, you know this better than I do, they're not just thinking about 2017 and 18, they're already thinking about, you know, even more out years, and if there's a sense that in 2018 or beyond, we might not have anything, then why would I even offer a plan in that environment? So I'm very concerned that this kind of, you know, economic instability could actually be made worse by what's potentially on the table for repealing parts of the Affordable Care Act.
I think we start with places where, you know, I think Senator Coburn and Representative Schwartz, they talked about, look, there's an agreement that the exchanges are not working terribly well right now. You've got, I think, between five and six million people who are paying the penalty rather than buying ACA coverage because they don't think it's valuable for them. I think you look at ways to bring the cost of that coverage down. You know, I think there are ways, you know, Speaker Ryan's Better Way Plan, you know, has what is probably a stronger inducement for people to buy coverage in terms of having, you know, a buy and hold approach to coverage where, you know, you could potentially be risk rated if you don't have a key coverage. So I think that there are ways you can improve the stability of the market. I also look at the MLR and say, you know, look, if you've got a lot of churn in this market, I think the other thing it's important to remember is the individual market, and I think some people, including myself, were surprised that there wasn't more employer dumping into the market. Well, I was totally wrong about that. And I think that's because people really value the stability and the value of employer-provided insurance. They really trust the employer to provide that. I think what we really need to think about is, okay, this is a residual market. Why is it a residual market? What do we need to do to help people who are in this market get access to coverage, include the ability of small employers to perhaps contribute to a plan that the IRS does not allow right now that could be used to purchase individual coverage on the exchanges? I would go back, and something that's, that, you know, President-elect and Trump administration could do tomorrow is say with 1332 waivers, we're gonna allow you to combine that with Medicaid funding, as long as it's deficit neutral, and go ahead and waive some of those requirements, some of the mandate benefits, and see if you can get a better option here. Maybe you're going to go with a high risk pool, maybe you're gonna bring back some kind of risk corridor or insurance subsidy. So there are strategies I think you can address the biggest problems in the exchanges, and address the cost and regulatory problems that would continue to, you know, as Paul said, drive really frenetic innovation that we know is needed. You do have some examples, oddly enough, in places like India, where they've shown you can provide world-class cardiovascular care through some of their hospitals or world-class cataract surgery at a fraction of the price, really by relying heavily on mid-level practitioners and, you know, taking kind of a, you know, an assembly line approach to doing high-volume surgeries where they can get incredibly good outcomes at very, very low cost. I think we need to drive more of that mentality here. I think that's, you know, we can do stabilize the residual market, improve the ability and attractiveness of that market for people who need to be in it or going to be in it for some period of time, help employers offer coverage in the small group market where we really see it erode and really attack healthcare costs and competition problems. If you bring down the costs, everything else gets easier.
Okay, so Paul, maybe I have two questions.
Yep.
Number one, on this discussion of the exchange market, how much did the allowance for kids up to age 26 stay on their parents' plan, and separately, the ability for the insurers to sell individual policies outside the exchanges contribute to the adverse selection within the exchanges? Would that, any of those things change?
Our understanding of studying it from the 26-year-old issue is corporate America funded most of that. It wasn't. I mean, so it was, you know, it was commercial policies, and
but if they had to run off their parents' plan,
yeah.
Would they have bought insurance on the exchanges, or would they
pay the
penalty?
Would they?
Would they have made a better, healthier market?
Yeah. Now we're into speculation.
I
think it's highly unlikely because there are all types of examples of those. I mean, the economics just don't work. When we survey these folks, they've run the numbers, and it is significantly less expensive for most of them to pay the penalty. And if it's not significantly less expensive, that means they're earning a very healthy income and they have commercial insurance for the most part. So they are making a economic, maybe people could say it's a short term, but it's certainly an economically rational decision, and I don't think it would have made much difference, to tell you the truth. The second part of your question wasn't 26-year-olds.
People can buy an individual policy outside the exchange, and I'm just wondering how that. Is that such a small market?
No, it's not such a small market. As you know, there's no subsidies outside the exchange. So for the most part, it's like 96 or 98% of those folks are above 400% of the federal poverty level. The pricing in most states, some states may be different, but in most states, you can't have, you know, completely separately priced products outside the exchanges, inside. And, you know, when you talk to the large carriers, they view it as their individual market segment, on exchange, off exchange is part of it, and the economics of that, as you know, as you've read, is very, very poor. It doesn't mean that was just the on exchange members. So
they're on scale either way. Yeah, just trying to figure out the interfaces that way. We're going to go to questions in just a couple of moments. So, as Doug said earlier, put on your thinking caps and stand up to the mic. My second, I'm interested in what kind of conversations you're having right now with your insurer clients,
yeah.
Given what Kavita was saying about the forecasting for the future.
Yeah. So, very uncertain. Very, very, very uncertain environment. I agree with Kavita that. If they're told you have to play by exactly the same rules next year, I think we're going to see fewer of them participating. It could be quite disruptive. There were a lot of hand money side deals cut this year between insurance commissioners and health insurers. And I think the calculus was very simple. And that is, if no one was offering health insurance, boy, that would be pretty obvious to the public. That's not a good thing. If we just have 40% premium increases, we can cover most of that with the subsidies, because subsidies, of course, are linked to wages, not the premiums. So the spread between wage increases every year, which might be 1-2%, and premiums, which is 40%, is a, you know, that spread is owned by the federal government, 100% of it, right? So that was a very easy calculation for this year. But, you know, the folks on off exchange who don't get subsidies kind of got hammered by that. And there's like 12% of the folks on the exchange that don't get subsidies either. So at some point that becomes an issue. But they are, you know, they have to submit products for 2018. They have to start submitting them in about less than 180 days, basically, right? April, May timeframe. So they are immediately worried about what will their decisions be for 2018. But again, to Kavita's point, there is no way they are going to be able to adapt. Even if the change came out in, let's say, I don't know, when does everyone get confirmed? March, April? There's no way they can respond that quickly to anything major for 2018. So I would find it very hard to believe that we could do anything material until 2019 at the soonest. And it's a whole new set of muscles they have to develop, because they kind of left and departed from that former individual market 3 or 4 years ago. So I think they're going to want an interim, I'm just guessing, they're going to want an interim plan that gives them some comfort and security that they're not going to lose another, 700 basis points of margin. That's what it was. We expected it to be larger this year, meaning when we fully reconcile 2016, and which won't be really till June or July of 2017, because the government pays it. So on the provider side, it's a little bit different. And the providers, I think, have come to realize that what they thought was going to be a good deal is not the greatest deal anymore. And the reason is, they gave up a lot on Medicare, what the formula was. They're getting hit very hard with balance after insurance, bad debt, because of these high deductibles. They are going to start to see dish payments evaporating, because that was part of the deal. And what they're learning is that it didn't just convert their uninsured patients into now Medicaid, but it also stimulated primary demand for elective surgeries and those types of things in Medicaid that the uninsured weren't demanding, and they're losing margin on that. So now they see their beds filling up with Medicaid patients that have, and if they had to expand their physical plan and capital, there's no positive return on investment on that. They're getting hit with balance after insurance, bad debt. Their Medicare reimbursements are not what they were going to be before the ACA passed, and DISH might evaporate. So, in the early year or two, first year or two, they said, "Oh, this is great," and you could hear whatever it is. You listen to the earnings call transcripts. Wow, we made $200 million on Obamacare this year, this quarter. Well, now the lines have reversed, and they have second thoughts. So. I think they'll be eager for change, I think it'll be a lot easier for the providers to adapt to this than the health insurers, whatever the change is. So there may be some impetus from the provider community more than the health insurance community to do it fast.
Do you have any questions from
Allyson?
Yes.
Tom Cranmer with Virginians for Quality Healthcare. My question is, how do you evaluate Tom Price's HR 2300?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that? Could I repeat it for the microphone? How do you evaluate Price's?
He has a bill titled HR.
Oh, Tom Price's HR 2300. I'm sorry, I didn't hear. Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Do you have that?
Howard.
I'm guessing that that's not going to be the vehicle. There is in the House, of course, the House passed the Better Way plan, not legislation, a plan that outlines there that's focused around refundable tax credits, methods for preventing re-risk rating for people with pre-existing conditions through a buy and hold of what you get from whole insurance, you won't be re-risk rated again, high-risk pools, and of course Medicaid per capita caps or a block grant and Medicare premium competition. I suspect that that's going to be, we've already had agreement, at least in principle, in the caucus in the House, and I think that that's, it's going to be harder for Republicans in the House to agree than it's going to be in the Senate. So I think that if you start from there, where you think you can hold your majority together in the House, that's going to be the vehicle. Where the rubber's going to be the road, of course, is what's the CBO score going to look like relative to current law.
The only thing I'd add is that it's been a while since I looked at Dr. Price's plan, Empower Your Patient Act, and there have been very different versions of the Better Way plan is the kind of latest version. You'll recall that there were kind of several iterations around premium support and some of the ideas that Speaker Ryan has had. So you have that in the mix. And then don't forget, do not discount that we have senators both sides of the aisle. I had just heard that I think Senator Collins is very interested in doing something herself. I mean, this is the time when everybody, if we know that there's a window for ideas on, quote, how to improve healthcare reform, it's not just going to come from one or two individuals. I can 100% guarantee that, having done this before. So I would say that you can look to what Dr. Price has done to look as a signal to say, these are ideas that have fueled his passion. When he becomes Secretary of HHS as a cabinet member, it's very different than being, you know, the head of the budget committee. So I would put that in one corner. I would say Speaker Ryan has had his ideas. They've iterated over the years. One of my colleagues at Brookings, Alice Rivlin, has worked on him with these ideas and has talked about kind of what premium support might look like. That has to all be done in the context of taking away some of these titles in the Affordable Care Act and replacing them, and the score is absolutely going to influence kind of how aggressive that is. And then we do have an entire Senate body who wants to have a name in this and have their own imprint on this. So for all those reasons, I do not see things happening quickly, because there are just too many people interested in having some influence on the process. So a repeal with a, quote, delay only undermines this instability that I worry about in not just the Medicare, Medicaid markets, but the commercial sector as well. So I'm a much more kind of, my sense of the world is that Dr. Price gets confirmed. He's got other cabinet positions that are important. Department of Treasury was very involved in the Affordable Care Act. I just want to make a comment that, you know, everybody puts this on HHS. We had probably more intense dialogues with the Treasury Department, so leadership in that sector is going to be hugely important. That all takes time. So I guess I'm a little more cynical that these things are going to happen, you know, quickly, and that we'll have some sense of what the world will look like in months. I think it'll take longer than that.
And I think you've heard from Republicans, they're tapping the brakes a little bit in the public comments.
You're hearing different voices about that, yeah, sure.
Can you step back here?
Paul Hellman with Hellman Simpson Partners. I follow health policy. So you just said it's going to take a little time. What, in your opinions, needs to be done to try to provide stability in the marketplace in the interim? Especially given Kavita's comments that, I mean, sort of the idea, and you have the Obama administration, what I think she was alluding to, the idea that the Obama administration put all this energy into signing people up is leaving. And you have an administration coming in that is sort of going in the opposite direction. You know, what needs to be done to keep insurers in the marketplace and to ensure that premiums are a little bit less onerous than they were for 17?
How many did you do that for?
Yeah, a couple things. So I think what a lot of the carriers would say is the special enrollment period is hurting them very badly. My understanding of the and what we, again, what we've learned from some of our surveys is you need 10 months of insurance to avoid the penalty, but you're covered for 90 days after you stop making the payments. So you can basically pay for 7 months of insurance, avoid a penalty, and get 10 months of coverage. And again, the consumer's pretty smart, right? So they've optimized that, and then they re-enroll in January. So the question is, if that happens, could we ask them to pay the prior 5 months? Prior 5 months that they missed. So I think that's, you know, they certainly talk about that a lot. I would start with that.
But given that you do have a member of Congress promising to repeal, even if we don't know exactly when that may happen, does that start the ball rolling to the process that Kavita and you were talking about? A company saying, well, why would I continue to sell in this marketplace and create the equity trying to build this market?
Well, I would say this, a lot of them will have to have assurances beyond what they have today for 2018 if they're going to participate. You know, they at least feel, and of course, Doug Badger's back there, he educated me today, you know, they feel kind of ripped off by this risk corridor thing, but, you know, the law, if you read it by the letter of the law, it really did what it said, the law said it was going to do. You know, this the CSRs and the potential of pulling that is another uncertainty for them. And who knows, I mean, that's more of a Supreme Court decision. So, and the real question is, are they outrunning the rapidly changing nature of the risk pool? First of all, a lot of these carriers have to make up minus 7, 8, 10% margin to start with. Reinsurance goes away completely. You know, there's no risk corridor payments. So you think about that, and you're already at, without trend, you're already at maybe, you could be up to 20%. And then you have trend on top of that, if the risk pool is stable, and then you have changing risk pool on top of that. So the real question is, what will this year look like? And are they outrunning the changing nature of the risk pool, which is generally going toward higher risk? And I think they'll make a decision based on that. My guess, if you ask me, I would say that we'll see the state insurance commissions giving a lot of leeway on premiums again next year. And that will, again, be the least disruptive route to keeping some level of stability in the system for a year.
Okay, I don't take more questions. So can we turn to Medicaid for a moment? Congresswoman Schwartz was talking about one of the main problems of having providers not participate in Medicaid is the very low reimbursements in many states to providers. There seems to be a lot of momentum, at least among Republicans, to block grant aid Medicaid. You heard a lot of that from Senator Coburn, and it's in Paul Ryan's better way, I think. And it's definitely something that President-elect Trump has been talking about. Does block granting offer any possibility for additional reimbursement? And if not, how else can it help Medicaid?
So the clearest signals around potentials in block granting have come from states that have kind of offered, or at least through the process of the Medicaid waiver, to do something similar to it. And just, I can just say that in my experience with kind of proposals around block grants, it is not necessarily kind of, it's not geared towards how can we get more providers to accept Medicaid. It really is, I hate to say this, just kind of a policy lever for cost control. And then states have to kind of deal and deliberate with, all right, well then who will provide the care? So let me just offer that in my kind of research and analysis, and it's been, I will confess to you, it's been 5 to 6 years since I've looked at this, because we knew that block granting wasn't something the Obama administration was gonna do. So prior to this, in the Bush administration, and in just thinking about options in Medicaid, we looked at some of this more formally, and that really felt like policy lever for cost containment, and I'll just leave it at that. What I would say about the likelihood is that if I had to kind of read the tea leaves, we have a named potential administrator for CMS who is a Medicaid expert, not a Medicare expert, Seema Verma. She actually, in the Bush administration, was able to work out a very creative Medicaid waiver that is now called Healthy Indiana, has received both praise and criticism because it does require for low-income individuals kind of the equivalent of what we do in Medicare Part B with means testing and a little bit more of the premiums paid by Medicaid members based on kind of their federal poverty level. So I would actually argue that even though the Better Way and all these things have block grants in there, a more likely scenario is to use existing on the books prior to the Affordable Care Act waiver authority to do what Dr. Coburn was talking about, where you let the floods of states come forward with their creative ideas. The feds will now have a lot more incentive through Administrator Verma to say, check, go on, go forth and conquer. And I predict that will be more likely than a block grant scenario. So maybe it'll be interesting to see if others agree or disagree, but I think that's where the tea leaves are shaking out on Medicaid reform.
I agree with Kavita. I think you've already got that authority. You also have the ability for the incoming Trump administration to say you can wrap Medicaid funding around exchange funding and try and look for maybe we're going to buy some of those Medicaid enrollees into private insurance if we can come up with a less expensive option in the exchange market. Maybe you also reduce churn across the markets that you can help your populations into the exchange. Maybe we have some people from Medicaid. I think that's right. You've got opportunity for tremendous innovation at the state level. You don't have to go through Congress to do a lot of this. And I think that's a smart opportunity there that both red states and blue states would think about. Now, I think where I've talked to Medicaid administrators before about this, there's been concern by both red states and blue states about what Congress is going to do to them and require them to do. So there's this concern there's going to be unfunded mandates put on them. So I think that CMS's approach to this is going to be really important to get buy-in, but they could get buy-in from both blue states and red states. They might want to try and do some really interesting things within the construct of the ACA.
Okay, we have like a few more minutes, so if you do have a question lying around your head, please feel free to stand up to the mic. But on the Medicaid issue, I mean, one of the things about Medicaid and other programs specifically for the poor is that they are right now economically pro-cyclical. And would a structure automatically reverse that? I mean, would they become a counter-cyclical program? You need more money when, you know, times are tough into this program. Or are any of the proposals that you've seen have a mechanism for increasing the funding when budgets need to be cut?
I think the approach that has been talked about is actually per capita caps.
Right, that's what I was just going to say. So,
I think the Republicans have actually talked a bit more about that to address those concerns, those counter-cyclical concerns. Because then if you're planning based categorically, for one thing, you can ensure there's, you know, funding for disabled that's going to be set, and that states aren't going to be tempted to cut funding for those expensive patients. And of course, it is counter-cyclical, so if there's a recession, more people go into the program, federal funding is automatically a ramp up.
And that maps to what I've, per capita caps fit into that solution and have had some, now I'm talking just based on, I think the notion of per capita caps have had some kind of vetting discussion amongst many different kinds of states, and there had been some attraction even in the last, I'd say, 3 to 4 years, some momentum around it.
I thought that in the mid-1990s, I may not be remembering correctly, that when block grants were last surfaced under President Clinton, there had President Clinton kind of proposed per capita caps.
Right, that's right.
And
then, Jim Sweeney, have you guys thought about HAIs and AMR and how that's going to impact the future?
When you say HAIs, I think of healthcare acquired infections. Is that what you're asking?
That's what
I'm asking. Okay, I'm sorry. Okay. I just want to make sure acronyms in one world are not necessarily the acronyms in another world. And I'm sorry, sir, what was your second HAI?
Antimicrobial resistance.
And how that impacts the kind of.
Yes.
So someone who deals with, I spend a lot more time looking at the impact of kind of nosocomial and healthcare acquired infections and just kind of the impact that might have on even our current spend. And antimicrobial resistance absolutely contributes to that, as well as a host of other problems and issues. So I think what you're hitting the nail on the head is something that, you know, when President Obama talks about kind of the three legs of the stool of the Affordable Care Act, we talk about cost, quality, and access. That quality piece is where some of what you're discussing gets kind of dumped in, but I don't think we've made anywhere near the progress on kind of how antimicrobial resistance or current delivery pattern behaviors are contributing to that. We've done a lot more to at least look and monitor infection rates, and certainly have seen once you tie readmission penalties and some of these financial incentives to those metrics, we've seen a decrease in those instances, but I would argue we're still just kind of scratching the surface. So that's my
opinion. Any thoughts in terms of moving that out? So if you're a parent, everybody knows that as soon as your kids go to school, bugs come back. There's nobody that, or if you're in the Army, you live in the barracks, suddenly you've got whatever Schmedlap down the way's got. We know these things, but we haven't ever addressed it from a holistic perspective because it crosses governmental lines. So, public schools could do a lot in terms of helping with vaccination and hygiene in the school.
but they don't.
Because there's a cost to it, and they don't directly benefit from it. There's no one that's roped that whole thing in, and I think that has to start. It has to be a holistic look, as opposed to that. But I don't know if anybody's, from the insurance perspective, that is doing that, from a medical perspective, because when I'm talking to various government people, I'm like, not my problem.
Yeah. So a couple of things. First of all, I think you're absolutely right that the challenges and the solutions to our issues today are increasingly residing outside the formal traditional healthcare financing and delivery system. And they're much more resident in schools, communities, the environment that goes well beyond healthcare. You know, we talk about transportation systems, nutrition systems, educational systems, and so on that are, because social context is now much, much, much more important to the solution than it ever was, right? I mean, we used to have contagious diseases and you had a center for disease control to try to, but I mean, we've, you know, I mean, we still have Zika and a few things like that, but we've largely eradicated.
But even if you look at the CDC, it's almost like it's mentally ill.
Right.
You've got one side, NIOSH, that will talk constantly about airborne threats.
Yep.
And you go to the other side of the CDC, there's really no airborne threats, it's just drop.
Yep.
Or, you know, it's almost a joke. So you've got one building, just the side of the building you're at, what's coming out of their mouth?
Yeah, I don't think we're going to solve the problem again. So what do we see? We do see provider systems who are, I'll give you a couple of characteristics, so capitated, stable population, integrated financially, which is a little bit redundant with capitated. They are now getting to these types of issues, and they're enlisting other, you know, what we would call mediating institutions in the community to help get to these folks and address these issues. And that's probably going to be the safest route to getting there. I don't think these things are going to be solved in state capitals. So we talk about DC to the state capitals. I think the state capitals are still way too distant from the social context of a community where an N of one matters, right? This isn't a cohort, it's really an N of one. And I think what you're talking about is the direction that it has to go, well outside the traditional healthcare system.
And delegating, so I would say that there are some emerging payment models that allow for this kind of population-based payment. So if you have a stable population and you actually say, you know what, you don't even, not to doctors, but to some entity that will take responsibility. And that's where I've actually seen dollars going to a school-based clinic. I mean, it's not perfect, but it's much better than kind of the existing system. And that's, you know, off politics, Democrats and Republicans should, you know, push for that type of behavior and care to be promoted. And I think we can get huge agreement that that's where we want to go.
Here we go, one more question. But as moderator's prerogative, I will, you know, I'm not supposed to answer questions. Say that as a journalist, having reported on local efforts of this kind, what you'll find is that, as Kavita said, a combination of sort of Medicaid, a city health department, and a charitable organization in the community working together to bring clinics to schools that not only students but also the parents can come to, things like that. Again, it's very, very small and localized. And there are those experiments going on sort of all over the country, I think. And our last question.
John Wilkerson, Insight on Policy. Dr. Coburn talked about taking the subsidies from the ACA, plowing that back into tax credits. So I'm not asking about the exchange, you guys can talk about that if you want, but I'm gonna stick to Medicaid for the question. Given how cheap Medicaid coverage is, if you took the reduction of FMAP from the expansion population and gave back that money as tax credits to those same people, would they be able to afford coverage? Because I mean, you're just giving them back what it costs for Medicaid treatment, but Medicaid is super cheap. Would you, in a sense, be giving them tax credits that they just don't use? Or would you end up, and maybe you had asked a question similar to this earlier, would you end up giving them more, like actually increasing Medicaid funding, because what it costs now would not be enough for an individual in a private market to buy insurance.
I can just say, I know this is, again, kind of areas that we looked at early on, 2008 even, 2009, in the Senate and in the White House to try to understand how could we think about tax credits as an option, and it was a way to find bipartisan consensus. And we ran into that same exact issue with the dollars in FMAP. It's not a one-to-one translation, but we would not necessarily be able to go into the private market and purchase that same quantity of healthcare. And by the way, that's actually exactly why there was some concerns and consternation about some of the proposals like Arizona had for using kind of a private exchange model for their Medicaid patients. But you saw that the administration allowed for that type of latitude. And I think that's where we could actually look to see, has it been a dollar for dollar in what people are able to purchase? So that was a concern that came up years ago in kind of the architecture of the ACA that I would still have to this day. But I think where you're getting at, and where I think Paul kind of started with this notion of, could you then also put responsibility on the state to help guide or navigate, I don't even know what the right word is, to help populations that might have these tax credits be able to be more savvy about what they're purchasing. And that's a very different set of skills than are in place right now at any Medicaid program, or as far as I've seen, in any kind of private marketplace. But that would be what you would need to kind of bridge, I think, the gap in what you're describing as drawing down off of FMAP and replacing that with tax credits.
I do think you've seen some the birth of some innovative delivery systems. You have, you know, programs like Q Lines out of Seattle and some others that basically work on we're going to be the primary care provider of choice. We're going to have a Medicaid managed care plan. The background is essentially offering kind of catastrophic care. But you had a physician-based practice saying we are going to provide, you know, basically unlimited primary care to this population, with the belief that we can manage that population much more effectively, keep them out of hospitals, improve primary health. That allows us to deliver a win even versus traditional Medicaid HMOs. So I think that's another model that's been put out there by some folks, is thinking of, you know, how can we get the providers really engaged in managing health in a way that, in a sense, offers an alternative vision of what insurance is for that population.
Do you have anything to add? Okay. Well, thanks everybody for being here. Appreciate all the participation in the discussion.